there are a lot of scary stories in the news. There's scary stories, and you know, cybersecurity related, but also stories about the way that sometimes algorithms can encode bias. You know, they can encode bias in language and sort of amplify that bias. And Catherine, I'd love to hear from you on that. They can also sort of misunderstand things. Context is critically important. And then the way that they're used can sometimes disenfranchise people. And if you're in an enterprise context, that could maybe be like, you've now messed up your audience segmentation or your recommendation engine or your ad targeting or something like that. Or it can be now you've actually disenfranchised people by denying a whole group of people a loan or by not having a system that understands how they speak or by not designing inclusive enough systems that people with disabilities or other kinds of design requirements can interact. So I'm just going to throw it out, but maybe Catherine, you can give us a start on that.
That was a fantastic intro, and I think that was a real intro to the problem. When we talked earlier about sort of the Swiss Army knife versus the individual, we look at these big systems that have learned from everything, and they've learned from the web, which means they've read the good of the web and the bad of the web. And so if you go out there, you sort of get introduced to this kind of thing if you're not thinking about it through just practical stuff. If you're looking at a system that's doing restaurant recommendations, is it likely to recommend certain ethnicities of restaurants more than others? And if you see that, you go in and you look at the data and you understand that there's a problem with that, right? And there's a reason why that's happening. It's because it's looking at the web and it's learning these biases. You know, one of these big monolithic, pretty much every one of these big monolithic domain general AI systems out there have biases encoded in them that come from the web. And even the big tech companies are only just starting to try to figure out how can we fix this, how can we bring it in, you know. There are systems out there that are more likely to say, you know, men are programmers and women are homemakers. And they bring those biases to the table, and when you use them, they you know, bring that into the process that you're using them for.
Not to be on the side of the computers in this situation, but algorithms are neutral, right? They start from neutral. They don't come, you know, it almost feels like the perception is that, you know, machine learning can just, you know, be negative, or it can just automatically encompass these bias on its own. Guess where it's getting the bias from?
Oh, yeah.
Us.
Right?
Us.
It's like,
yeah.
It's essentially codifying our own biases, or at least the ones we're even aware of.
Because the algorithms are neutral, but they're this wonderful quantitative mirror into what actually exists today. The glue of our society does indeed rest often upon polite fictions. And often these tools reveal all of the things that lie beneath some of the social tissue and glue. And that can be an amazing opportunity for business people to come in and think about the values that their companies espouse, because we have the choice to analyze where there might be biases after we built a system and then go through and say, no, I don't want that outcome. And it leads to an interesting paradox for the technologist, because, and this is coming from the fairness community that I work in the machine learning community, where most technologists, as a data scientist, they're trying to optimize for the accuracy of their algorithm. So get it as good as possible at doing what we want it to do. But often in these social questions, accurate is not fair, is not what we want. We don't want, an accurate thing might be, hire that white guy because he looks like everybody else we used to hire. And then you might say, but no, but we don't want that. So pitch it different, and it shifts around what we look for in the tools, but I think it's really cool because we're empowered to change things.
I'm going to be honest here, which is that once we started doing debiasing on our models, our accuracy went up, actually, for customer service. Mm-hmm. When we've debiased some of the customer service work we've done, and we've looked at, so these big, we have an ensemble system as our base model, and then we do transfer learning, you debias the base model, right? And once you do that, you realize your accuracy goes up for the end task.
Cool.
Yeah. Which is cool.
I've seen it also go down, and then you have to make a risk-oriented trade-off regarding what you want to optimize.
But you don't assume that it's going to make your accuracy go down.
For sure,
it doesn't happen all the time.
Before we were doing AI, and we were doing explicit programming, and you know, kind of if this, then that, we would go to our customers and try to understand their problems, and programmers would try to understand what the reality is that we were trying to code against. In this era of AI, we've been talking about all the data that we need, the big data that we need to do that, data itself is now the proxy for reality. And what we're seeing here is with these tools, sometimes those fictions that you're talking about that allowed us to live comfortably in our lives, the reality that we are seeing in our data is something that we're having to face for the first time, because there's no barriers between us and that data. And it's very important to recognize that as we take the next few steps forward, because these biases will continue. We're producing ever more quantities of data on you know, exponentially at this point. And so the problem of bias is only going to grow in the years ahead.
The notion of proxies is, for me, honestly, the key ethics question for an enterprise. Super important that you map out just where customers touch and like what a process looks like so that you know what your proxy is actually going to get good at optimizing for, because it might be different than what you think it's doing. Yeah.
So we have just a few minutes left, and I want to make sure we hit our predictions for this section. Chris Benson, Tom, and Catherine Hume, I'd love to hear kind of what you cooked up in your lunchtime discussion.
For me, I'd say like the number one thing is we prepare for an era of uncertainty. I think for years we've been going around saying things are changing faster than ever. And it's been the pace of change which has been the hardest thing for people to deal with. I actually think now it's the degree of uncertainty. Like, the reality is that more than any other time ever before, we just have no idea how things are going to go. We have no idea if AI is going to run away and create this entire world of transhumanism and another consciousness. We have no idea if we're going to kind of rebel against
it. We just decide it won't. can we actually like make a pact
we'll make sure it doesn't happen. But on the other end of this game, like, maybe we're going to become sort of neo-Luddites and we're going to sort of throw away our smartphones and ensure that no one can track our location, and we're going to stop using Google Maps because we hate our data being aggregated that way. The reality is the sort of the standard deviation for the prediction of the world has probably never been greater than before, and therefore it's like essential within all of us that we prepare for a future where we're going to have to change, our careers will change, the value we add will change, the meaning of our lives will change, and that's something we fundamentally need to prepare for.
But to echo Tim O'Reilly's book, like, we're in control. Like, we can make the determination of what happens, right?
Yeah, sure. Well, agree. Tim also said, who's run out of work? I mean, you know, and that's one of the things that I tell people is, how many of you finish your work in a day? Mm-hmm. Right? So don't you want technology to help you so that you get some more done? And it's the same with, and Tim says this often, which is, I don't worry that we'll run out of jobs. Yeah. We've just got to get to where we can transform.
The big question that goes back to uncertainty is, there's a lot of this time it's the same, and we've seen this before, whether it's the Luddites, whether it's the advent of computers, whether it's the paperless office, like, we end up making pretty lousy predictions, and actually things remain much more similar than we ever thought before. But there is a kind of lingering feeling that there are logical reasons to think that this time is different. So.
But you think that every time, though. Every time we think that.
I mean, what it really comes down to is that we've all agreed that you can't predict the future. The world is changing ever more, and that is only accelerating. And so there comes a point where you have to accept that there's only so far into tomorrow that we can see, and you need to start organizing yourself around that.